afternoon, and welcome to the 29th annual Chappel Memorial Lecture. My name is Gordon Kirby, Associate Dean of Research. I'll be emceeing the lecture. I'd like to extend a special welcome to Dr. Cliff Chappel and his wife Marilyn, who are able to attend the lecture this year. I'll give you a little bit of background on the lecture and maybe an introduction to our speaker today. So this memorial lecture series was started in 1988 by an endowment from Dr. Chappel in memory of his father, Herbert James Chappel. And since the inception, we've been able to invite a number of internationally renowned scientists to come speak to us on their research programs and their career progression, and provide some more motivation for graduate students interested in biomedical sciences. Dr. Gary Nabel is our speaker today, and he's excelled in a variety of professional appointments ranging from academia to government to industry. He's currently with Sanofi, the global healthcare leader, where he's chief scientific officer and senior vice president for global research and development. He chairs the Strategic Development and Scientific Advisory Council there and the Ebola response coordination team. Prior to joining Sanofi, Dr. Nabel was with the National Institute of Health, where he served as director of the Vaccine Research Center at the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Disease. At the NIH, Dr. Nabel provided direction and scientific leadership for basic clinical and translational research activities at the VRC, and he guided development of novel vaccine strategies against HIV and other emerging and re-emerging viruses. Dr. Nabel graduated from Harvard College in 1975 and continued his graduate studies at Harvard, completing his PhD in 1980 and his MD 2 years later. Then he became a postdoctoral fellow in the laboratory of David Baltimore at MIT's Whitehead Institute before joining the NIH. He was a professor of internal medicine and biochemistry and investigator at the Howard Hughes Medical Institute at the University of Michigan, where he was director of the Center for Gene Therapy and co-director of the Center for Molecular Medicine. In recognition of his expertise at the forefront of virology, immunology, gene therapy, and molecular biology, Dr. Nabel was elected to the Institute of Medicine at the National Academy of Sciences in 1988. I heard Dr. Nabel speak at the Mariel Scholar Symposium several years ago and was impressed by his passionate and engaging speaking style. He spoke on developing a vaccine for HIV and thought he would be a perfect guest lecturer for the Chappel Memorial Lecture. And we're very fortunate to have him here today to speak on harnessing the immune system to fight emerging viruses and cancer.
Thanks, Gordon. It's really a pleasure to be here today, and I'd like to thank you for your hospitality. I will say that it's been wonderful visiting the institution. It actually reminds me a lot of where I started my career with the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, which is just down the road. And I really have enjoyed hearing about the exciting research here, particularly in the College of Veterinary Medicine. I'd like to thank the Chappels as well for sponsoring not just this lecture, but the extraordinary numbers of lectures over the years. That's quite a hallowed tradition, and I feel humbled actually to be part of this seminar series. What I wanted to share with you today are some insights into advances in how we can use the immune system to fight human disease. You know, I think that one thing that's become evident really over the last several years is that we've learned enough about the immune system, how it works, what its potential is, what some of its limitations are. But importantly, we've learned about ways to manipulate it and turn the tools of the immune system into tools that we can actually use to develop new medicines for patients. And I think that we're seeing unprecedented advances in the area of infectious disease, and the area of cancer immunotherapy. And so what I want to do is go through three topics today. The first one will be related to HIV. The second really touches upon how some of the advances in HIV and AIDS vaccine research can actually be used and applied to cancer immunotherapy. And so that will be, and I'll do that in a relatively abbreviated fashion, although happy to take questions because it's a big, big area. And lastly, I wanted to finish with a description of some of the work that's been going on more recently at Sanofi in the area of dengue vaccine development. We recently were able to license a vaccine, the first ever vaccine for dengue, which I'll share some of the experiences that we had developing that vaccine. And lastly, since dengue is a very close cousin and is probably in some ways, it's certainly at least coexisting in parts of the world where we see Zika virus, I just want to tell you about some of the newer efforts we're making to contribute to the development of a Zika vaccine. Now, what I want to do in terms of emerging infections is to start with AIDS. AIDS, I think, it represents the most stark example of what viruses can do when they're not really managed and contained early in their outbreak. We've gone from a situation where this virus was essentially non-existent in the world, or certainly existent in handfuls of individuals back in the 1960s, to a point where more than 60 million people in the world have been infected, and over 30 million people have died. And so I think it is really one of those lessons that we've lived through, and I think the hard way, been forced to reckon with our inadequate preparation for emerging outbreaks. And that's the theme I'll circle back to at the end with Zika virus. Now, we've been lucky in some respects with HIV because we have been able to develop antiviral drugs. When the disease first appeared on the scene, essentially, if you were infected with HIV, it was a death sentence. You would be lucky to live 5 years when we first encountered it in hospitals, which I did as a young medical intern back in the 1980s. With the advent of antiretroviral therapy, it actually is one of maybe the most profound successes that we've seen in terms of treating the disease, where we essentially turned what was a death sentence in 5 years to a life where you could expect to live out in your normal lifespan. Nowadays, with antiretroviral therapy, subjects who are infected have a normal lifespan, over 30 years. So it's been a tremendous success story in that regard, except that the antiviral drugs don't get rid of the infection. The people who take the drugs have chronic side effects. They suffer from other complications of the therapy, and it's not fun to take medicines every day and not have to skip a dose or else to see your disease progress. So ultimately, the goal and the end game for HIV is to develop a vaccine that could eradicate the virus. That's been a difficult task, and so what I want to do first is just tell you a little bit about what the lessons have been from clinical trials, where we stand on clinical trials for HIV. And then I'll talk a little bit about where I think some of the promise is. And that's where I want to jump into where I think some of the new immune technologies could really put us in a very different place than we've been. The first efficacy trials, meaning phase 2B or phase 3 studies to evaluate the ability to prevent HIV infection began in about 1999. They were protein-based vaccines. They went for about 4 to 5 years. The vaccines were made by a small biotech company called Vaxgen. The bottom line is that those trials failed. They were GP120 vaccines, which is the one part of the viral envelope. I'll tell you a little more about the viral envelope in a second. That was discouraging. As if that wasn't discouraging enough, excuse me, there was a subsequent trial conducted by Merck that used viral vectors, adenoviral vectors, to try to stimulate the cellular immune system. And that's the STEP trial. Began in about 2005, mid-2005. It's actually stopped prematurely in 2008 for futility because it didn't work. So a humoral immune response vaccine and a T-cell immune response vaccine did not work. There was a third trial that was done, and it came out of a prototype that we generated at the Vaccine Research Center. It was done with a consortium supported by the NIH, the HIV Vaccine Trials Network. That combined both. It had both a antibody component and a T-cell component. That trial began in 2009, and by 2012, that trial was stopped for futility because it didn't work. Now, the only glimmer of hope in all of AIDS vaccine research came from this one trial that was conducted in Thailand by the U.S. Military Health Research Organization. And that trial was published in 2009. Is that right? Yeah, it was 2009 in the New England Journal of Medicine. And, you know, seasoned vaccinologists might say, well, why are you getting so excited about this? This is the curve from the paper of vaccinees or from subjects who received a placebo versus a vaccine in the Thai trial. And you see that there actually is a splaying of the curves, and the people who received the vaccine showed a lower incidence of infection than the placebo control group. It was a modest effect. It was about 31% reduction in infection. And it actually was limited in duration, because what you can see is that most of the effect you have here, once you get past, you know, a year, these curves are paralleling each other in terms of the rates of infection. So it was limited in duration, it was modest, but it actually was a very important trial, at least in terms of knowledge creation. Because what it did is, for the very first time, it provided a proof of concept that you could actually prevent HIV infection. Most people who were doing HIV vaccine trials back in those days never dreamed that a vaccine would actually prevent infection. They were hoping that, well, maybe the people who got infected would have a milder course of disease. And so from a public health point of view, what this trial said to us is, well, there is a way to prevent HIV infection in humans. And if we can learn how this trial worked and how to make it better, then we have a shot down the road of making a better vaccine. And now there are multiple offshoots of this trial that are going forward and with various partners involved. The NIH is involved. The Gates Foundation is involved. In this trial, Sanofi actually makes the Alvac component. Actually, I believe it was originally made here in Canada at the Sanofi facility outside of Toronto. And then there was a protein component. And for the new trial, another pharma company, Novartis, is actually making the protein. So those trials will go forward, and we will see whether or not we can improve on it. Although it's a challenge when you have a very complicated vaccine regimen, a very complicated host population, and the trials do take a long time. Trials can take, in the very best case, if you can do a trial in 3 years, that's lightning quick. So we, while this is going on, are looking for other ways to get highly effective vaccines. Now, this is where I want to touch briefly on why I actually think there are some bright spots in terms of our ability to develop preventive treatments for HIV. And the bright spots are really driven by our advances in science. And I'll quickly outline what those are. And the reason I'm going to quickly outline them is that there are essentially two major advances in the field of HIV research since 2009 that I think have really turned the vaccine world on its head. They are discoveries that we never expected would be possible. And I then want to show you how we can turn that knowledge into new approaches to preventing HIV. So what I'm showing here on this slide is the HIV viral envelope. The HIV viral envelope is composed of three monomers. You can sort of see the outlines of them here. They're highly decorated with glycans. Those are these fuzzy pieces here on the outside. This is the part of the virus that will engage the host cell by binding to CD4. This part is buried in the viral membrane, and so this envelope will deliver the nucleic acid from HIV into the CD4 positive cell. And what we learned starting in 2009, this is due to a confluence of factors, a better understanding of how B cells become activated, better understanding of how to rescue antibodies from B cells, better understanding of the structure of the HIV viral envelope. That understanding of structure essentially gave us a hook that we could use to pull out antibodies that would bind to very highly conserved domains in the viral envelope. And so for the very first time in 2009, we began to see these newly recognized, they were there all the time, we just didn't have a way to isolate them, what I would call broadly neutralizing antibodies to HIV. Because that's been the stumbling point for HIV, that the virus is so diverse, so genetically diverse, so biochemically diverse, and so masked by these glycans and these recesses which have essentially evolved to escape immune recognition, that it was really impossible to approach the virus. Now, I'm going to tell you in a second more about one particular antibody called VRC01 that recognizes a highly conserved site on the virus, and that site is the site that recognizes CD4, which is the receptor for the virus. And as you can imagine, a virus cannot replicate, at least in CD4 T cells, unless it can recognize CD4. So among the many things the virus can change, because it's highly mutable, it can't change this. It basically has to retain its ability to bind to CD4. And since 2009, what we've recognized is that there now are a total of about 5 sites on this viral envelope that are highly conserved and that are functionally required for viral replication. So it's the CD4 binding site. These are just the names of individual antibodies that recognize these sites. There's this region close to the membrane proximal region that is in the GP41 molecule. That's the part of the virus that has to undergo rearrangement and create the fusion protein so that the virus can actually put its genetic material into a target cell. There's an interface region where the trimers form. And again, that part can't change because the virus has to stay together as a trimer in order to be an effective engine for viral entry. And again, that also is an antibody that helps us define these intact, functionally active proteins. And then there are 2 sites that actually recognize sugars. So I mentioned that there are many, many sugars on the virus. It turns out that the immune system has picked out 2 sites, one at the very tip of the virus, the V1, V2 region, where it recognizes the sugar in association with the protein backbone. This is called the V1, V2 apex. And it's, again, important for both viral entry and for tethering the virus together. And lastly, this mannose patch, which is at the intersection of the trimers, which also probably both helps hold the virus together and shields it from the immune system. So since 2009, we've now, in our hands, gone from having 0 antibodies to literally having thousands of antibodies that have been derived from, some from the same patients, some by this initial probing mechanism, some by deep sequencing, by just looking at the sequences of other immunoglobulins from those same patients. And literally having a range of reactivity that we didn't think was possible. I'm going to tell you what we've been able to do with this one prototype and how we can use this both as a possible prevention for HIV and also as a stepping stone to a vaccine. So this was the basic science discovery number one that has really changed the field. Discovery number two has been that prior to just last year, we could put up a structure of this virus trimer, but it was a hypothetical structure. It was the only thing we knew about the virus at the level of precision of X-ray crystallography was what the monomer looked like. But within the last year, we now have seen some breakthroughs using cryo-electron microscopy. This came from John Moore's lab in New York, at Cornell in New York, Ian Wilson and Andrew Ward at Scripps. There's another paper that I won't show you from Peter Kwong where he's actually solved the crystal structure. But the wonderful news is that we now have the structure of the trimer at fairly high resolution. This is a 5.8 angstrom structure. Peter, by crystallography, has this under 2 angstroms, so very high resolution. And not only do we have the structure of the trimer, but we have the structure of the trimer complexed to these really outstanding antibodies that neutralize them. So we can see exactly what the relationships are between virus and antibody. You know, the friend and foe. And friend is the antibody, the foe is the virus, but how they have to engage to give us protection. And that, I think, represents a way forward for us to develop vaccines. So last part of this portion of the talk, I want to give you kind of an outline of how we can go forward with these kinds of tools and why we're so excited about the opportunities. So the model here, and again, this is really something that that is for the first time being worked out in the HIV vaccine field, is how do we use this paradigm of what I call structure-based vaccine design to make progress against protecting against these viruses. So here's the GP120, the monomer structure bound to CD4, the broadly neutralizing antibody VRC01. One of the things I will tell you is one of the reasons this antibody works so well and why it neutralizes so many strains is that it binds to the CD4 binding site. Here it's shown in green. The last slides it was shown in yellow. And the reason it does that is that it actually forms structurally a molecular mimic of CD4 itself. I could almost overlay the structure of CD4 on top of this antibody structure that's engaging that site. So it's really a case of molecular mimicry. But knowledge of the structure, more importantly, allows us to do two things. It now allows us to say, well, okay, now here is a structure, and here it is shown and highlighted in yellow. That's the thing I want to present to the immune system. And so now I will design my vaccines to, you know, maximize the exposure of the part of this virus that I want to generate an immune response. That's what I call the active immunization approach. The other approach we can take is to actually use this antibody that recognizes the site and say, well, you know what, if I already have this antibody, why do I need to induce it by a vaccine? Why can't I just make that antibody and use that antibody to protect? So I'm going to say a word about both. The most important thing about the advances, the scientific advances on AIDS vaccines, is that when we find a subject who does make an immune response to the virus, we can go in and we can do deep sequencing and we can actually use the molecular genetics essentially to trace the pathway of immunoglobulin diversification. We can say, you know, we know that the immunoglobulin started in the germline, we know that it's somatically mutated, and then we can trace the path that this antibody had to take to generate that antibody. And here, for example, is an analysis using bioinformatics of the precursor antibodies and the pathways that these antibodies must take to get to a mature broadly neutralizing antibodies. And we pay particular attention to the common forks in this road because we know that if multiple donors get there and they share a common path of evolution, those are critical nodes for the development of an effective immune response. And importantly, we can make these synthetically because we have the sequences, and we can essentially then reconstruct those antibodies and reconstruct what has to fit into those antibodies to elicit that immune response. And that's happening, and there's really exciting progress that's being made. It's not all solved, but you will see if you look in the literature at a number of laboratories that have now shown abilities to engage the germline form of VRC01 and some of the intermediates along the way. So it's a hugely invaluable tool, and it's really the first time we've ever tried to use this kind of a rational approach to vaccine design. Now, what I want to spend a little bit more time on is this idea of passive transfer. Now, you know, I think it's worth taking a step back just for a second and thinking about the impact of antibodies in human medicine. You know, I was a graduate student in, I don't even want to say the year, when monoclonal antibodies were discovered by Kohler and Milstein. And I'll give you a hint, it was before 1980. And everybody said, you know, these antibodies are gonna have a major impact on human health, and they're gonna be a fantastic way to treat disease. And the next 5 years went by and everybody's waiting for the first monoclonal antibody. And there were all sorts of technical problems, never for humans, I should say. They were great laboratory reagents, but to turn one into a human, you know, medicine didn't happen. So that brought us into the 80s. And then everybody said, well, the next 5 years, we're almost there. So mid-80s showed up, no antibodies. Everybody said, well, the next 5 years, let's go to early 90s. Well, it took until about 1999 where the first monoclonal antibody was developed to treat human disease. And since then, you know, you've all heard about the Humiras and the great and rituximab for treating lymphoma and the IL-6 for treating inflammation. And we went from 1999 to today where there were no medical products to treat human disease to today where the spending in terms of healthcare in monoclonal antibodies now is over $20 billion a year in monoclonal antibodies, and there are over 40 licensed products. So it's a lesson in, you know, when you see that there's potential in a technology, don't give up on it too soon. And the second thing is make sure you're young, if you can. But the great news is that we are at a point now where it's certainly very easy to make antibodies that can go into clinical trials, to have the production technology to make it at the scale that you need to treat human disease. And with our knowledge of antibody structure, we can improve the potency, reduce the manufacturing costs, so we can actually conceive of the possibility of using the antibody itself for prevention, okay? And that's the next part I'm just gonna tell you about. So with VRC01, as I mentioned, it recognizes the CD4 binding site. It's that it has to be functionally conserved. It neutralizes over 90% of diverse viruses prior to VRC01, which really was one of the prototypes, and we essentially, in these two papers that are on this slide, we discovered it at the VRC between my lab, John Muscola, and Peter Kwong. And the remarkable thing here shows in red all of the viruses from diverse clades that are neutralized by it really at high potency. And so we thought this would be a good prototype to look at in terms of its ability to prevent disease. In animal models, and I can't stress how important in the HIV world these models are, particularly this non-human primate lentivirus model, which really pretty nicely mimics human infection. You can see that we get a nice dose-dependent protection of animals that have been challenged with a simian chimeric human immunodeficiency virus. This is one that can replicate in monkeys. You can see at 20 mg per kg, all animals are protected. 5 mg per kg, all animals are protected. And finally, when you drop it low enough, 0.3 mg per kg, you start to see some breakthrough cases, which is actually what you want to see. You want to see that there's a dose response. But it does tell us that it's possible to protect in vivo in a non-human primate, which of course gives us a lot more incentive and a lot more confidence to move forward into human studies. This was published in 2014 in Science Translational Medicine, as shown on this slide. And so we have moved it forward. In fact, these studies now have been done since I left the NIH, but using, you know, essentially the reagent we created from that initial antibody. And in this paper published in Science Translational Medicine, what you can see is when you give it to individuals who are infected with HIV, there is a drop in viral load. It's a single dose so that over time the levels return back to normal. But also what I will say is I think that even if this was given multiple times, if you only target a single epitope on this virus, we know this virus is capable of mutating, and it's very unlikely that an antibody to a single epitope is going to give you strong long-term protection or suppression of the virus. And so that's gotten us to thinking about how we can do that better. And so this is now where I want to begin to go off into the next generation of immune technologies and how our understanding of antibodies themselves offers us new opportunities. This is conventional immunoglobulin, heavy and light chain, and each one of them has a variable region, an FV region that reacts with antigen, and it's bivalent. What we did, and this was done by scientists at Sanofi before I came there, not for HIV, but for other targets, is that they realized that they could stack these two variable regions, one on top of the other, molecularly. So we now had a reagent where there were two variable regions. And when I was actually at the NIH and we tried to do this, we actually were never able to do it successfully because we made fusions of these two variable regions. And what we found is that the terminal one always worked. We could get the terminal variable region to engage its target, but the proximal one never did. And that's because the terminal one was sterically hindering the more proximal one. What the guys at Sanofi had done is they looked at the structures and they realized this, and they realized if they put a little molecular kink in the molecule, they could tilt them so they wouldn't interfere. And in fact, they brought forward an antibody of this type, not for HIV, but for inflammation, into human trials. And this antibody had a normal half-life. It wasn't immunogenic. It actually had a very nice profile in humans. So that actually piqued our interest in terms of applying this technology to HIV. And we said, well, what happens if we take two of these broadly neutralizing antibodies and we make a bivalent monoclonal antibody, bispecific. Now, some of you may ask, why do that? Why not just mix two antibodies together? Why stack them one on top of the other? It's actually, in this case, for a very practical reason. Every time we make a biologic product and we have to make it at large scale, usually we have to make it in a 20,000 liter bioreactor that's bigger than this building and bigger than most of the buildings around here. So if you have to make two of those products instead of one, it really represents a lot of additional effort and time and expense. And so there's an economy in having two things in one. But I'm going to show you another reason later, because there's some other potential in the technology. But quickly, what we found here is that when we made the fused form of the two antibodies as opposed to mixing them together, we were able to retain, in this case, we actually got a slight improvement, about a threefold improvement in potency of neutralizing those targets. So we could essentially get two for the price of one. And importantly, what we found is that at low antibody concentrations, this sort of bears out what I was saying earlier about combinations, that we could get neutralization of more viruses by having the two antibodies there together than by having either one alone. And so that argues for having the combination of antibodies, and even better, having them both together. Now, what we realized, and this was really due to the postdocs in the lab who were working here, is that we could actually go one step further, where we could take this original technology of stacking the two variable regions on one another, but instead of making a dimeric antibody, we could actually make a chimera by essentially using a molecular clamp to put a single chain of the immunoglobulin together with the double chain. And that allowed us to make a trispecific antibody. And now that gave us a chance in HIV to actually target three specificities at once. And I'll just quickly show the data here because there's a lot more I want to get to. But when we then compared this trispecific antibody to any of the monospecifics, these are some of the best monospecifics in the world, what we found is something that was really pretty unprecedented. At the top here, you see the number of viruses that are actually resistant to this antibody. For any of the monoclonals, there are very few resistant there are actually a number that are resistant. In this case, there might have been one that was resistant to this trispecific antibody. The median titer for getting neutralization was much higher. It was in the nanogram per mil level, 10 nanograms or less. And there were a bunch of viruses that were actually being neutralized even at a concentration of less than a nanogram per mil. So that allows us to improve the breadth, it allows us to improve the potency, and it allows us to manufacture one product instead of three products. And you can see, as you project out from, you know, our understanding of the science and how we can attack these vulnerable points on the virus, to actually how we can make that into a product that actually could be manufactured and made available to patients, that combination of factors actually really, I think, puts us in a place where we might be able to do this. And so we now have a cooperative research and development agreement between Sanofi and the NIH to move forward on some of these multi-specific antibodies, and those will go forward in trials. Now, the real unanswered question as we move forward is, do antibodies protect against HIV-1? I showed you monkey data that suggests they probably do. But the real question is, as good as that monkey model is, it was done with a single virus, and the monkey's immune system is not quite the same as a human. What will happen in humans? And so, believe it or not, the trial is now being done to ask that question. And the reason we're doing it is to ask the question, can antibodies work? What level of antibodies are required? Where and how do those antibodies protect? What parts of the antibody are giving that protection? And again, this is a trial that's being done supported by NIH and being done between the HIV Vaccine Trials Network and the HIV Prevention Trials Network. And they're infusing two different doses of the VRC01 antibody, 30 mg per kg and 10 mg per kg, comparing that to placebos looking in North America and South America, as well as in sub-Saharan Africa, and the subjects are getting dosed every 8 weeks for 10 doses, and they will be followed out, and we will see in humans whether or not this works. So stay tuned. I think the trial has started, and patients are now enrolling, and I think it's logistically not simple, but if it does work, there are improvements coming behind, like the tri-specific that I just showed you, and other modifications of antibodies that might allow us to give those at lower frequency. I did want to just say one word before I leave HIV about another potential application of these antibodies for immunotherapy, and that's the possibility of using these bi-specific or possibly in the future tri-specific antibodies to actually purge the reservoir of latent HIV in humans and really get at what I think we all would love to see. We either develop a vaccine that will prevent this disease from occurring at all, or for those who've already been infected, if we could get to the point where we could target the reservoir, we would love to get them off of their antiviral drugs and essentially give them a cure from their infection. Cure can mean a lot of things. What we're really aspiring for is not that, you know, there's zero virus left in them, but that they don't have to stay on antiviral drugs. It's what we call a functional cure. There have been three papers on this. One of them is from our group here. I'm going to show you quickly just one slide from that paper. And again, this is a slightly different bifunctional antibody approach. In this case, one arm is directed to the highly conserved site of the virus. The other one targets a protein on T cells that will activate T cells called CD3. And the idea is this, that if you have a CD4 positive cell that contains virus latently, every T cell has CD3 on its surface, this reagent will bind via CD3. That CD3 signal is the physiologic signal that will induce the virus from latency. Once the virus is induced from latency, it now expresses the GP120 on its surface. And then this antibody does something different. It now binds to that molecule expressed on the surface of the cell. And guess what? Its other end is hanging out there, and out circulating in the blood are killer cells, CD8 cells, that can then go ahead and kill that cell that had been previously latently infected. So it's essentially a way of waking up the virus and then killing it using this bispecific approach. We have some data that's in the paper, and I'll just show you highlights here. In one case of virally infected cell lines that are killed in the presence of T cells, these are just four different lines compared to control, so it does work, both in constitutively activated cells and in latently infected cells. And then we actually have looked in primary T cells, and again, this is all in the paper. Came out in Nature Communications, where we see a reduction of the amount of provirus in normal T cells. So these antibodies can have multiple uses. They can be used for immunotherapy. They can be used for prevention. There's still work to do for this particular approach, but I think that we now see paths forward for HIV that we didn't see a few years ago. So, to summarize the first part of the talk, I hope I've convinced you that our understanding of HIV entry has provided us this opportunity for AIDS vaccine development through the definition of these highly conserved and functionally required structures that are the target of neutralizing antibodies. We're moving forward with tests of concept with the antibody trials. We are very excited about new antibodies, not just both the new traditional antibodies, the monovalent antibodies, but now bispecific antibodies and more recently trispecific antibodies, and how they can contribute to both prevention and cure. And finally, we think that I do want to make sure, even though I didn't talk a lot about it, having the access to the trimer structure is also very complementary and will no doubt continue in parallel to these antibody efforts, because as we're using the antibody efforts, we can still keep designing immunogens for more traditional types of vaccines. Now, I'm going to be brief in this section because we could spend a whole day, or if not weeks, Byron knows this well, working in this field. But I really want to just say a couple of words, because once you start creating these new types of modalities, you can see that they do also offer new approaches to treating diseases other than infectious diseases. And in this case, I just want to talk for a second about cancer immunotherapy. What we've learned, and I think, again, where there's really tremendous amounts of excitement, both in the academic community, the medical community, the pharmaceutical community, is that after probably, like with monoclonal antibodies, more than 30 years of research, we're starting to see bright spots in terms of responses to immune therapy. Now, these get a lot of publicity on TV, and they deserve it. I mean, I think probably the most personal example of somebody we all know and love who benefited from these new checkpoint inhibitors was Jimmy Carter, who presented with brain lesions with his melanoma. And as far as I know these days, and I don't know it through anything other than him, so I'm not violating HIPAA when I tell you this, because he's been public about it, is that at least as far as anyone can tell right now, he's in remission due to probably a combination of radiation and the checkpoint inhibitors, which is pretty remarkable for somebody who had brain metastases. And there are now, multiple ways we can use our knowledge of the immune system to target cancer cells. The checkpoint inhibitors, which is the treatment that Jimmy Carter and more importantly, many patients with melanoma have benefited from, are directed to PD-1. There are newer trials with its ligand called PD-L1, CTLA-4 from Jim Allison. These are approaches where we essentially take controls on the immune system that acts as brakes, and they stop the immune system from responding to the cancer. And when we give the antibodies, we essentially let the brakes off. We take the brakes off. And as we call it, it's our way of overcoming immune suppression. And you will see now in the coming years different checkpoint inhibitors, different mechanisms of immune suppression, regulatory T cells, TGF-beta, other types of immune modulators, and I think that's going to be one other very important approach. You will see work here, though, on the other side, which is activating the immune system to respond to tumors, and that might be through oncolytic viruses like Byron and his group that are studying them and using them here, vaccines, adjuvants, and even some gene delivery approaches of agonistic molecules that can stimulate the immune system. There are also ex vivo approaches with cells you can take out of the body and grow and give them back to patients. A little bit harder to do that logistically for large numbers of patients, but in the small numbers that have been studied, remarkably effective in certain tumor types, and then even angiogenic factors. The point I want to make is that we now have ways, when you look at how these checkpoint inhibitors work and how the immune system functions to recognize foreign antigens, they never see things in isolation. It's never that you see a single receptor contacting a single target cell. What you usually see are clusters of molecules. So you will see, in the case of the checkpoint inhibitors, the T cell receptor has to recognize foreign MHC that's presenting peptides. And then there are accessory molecules that will stabilize that interaction. LFA and ICAM, for example, CD40 ligand. You then, later in the process, get other clusters, like the PD-1. PD-1 stands for programmed death 1. PD-1 was meant to be a way to kind of cycle these cells out and get rid of them once the immune response was done in terms of its work. What tumors have figured out is that if they artificially induce that PD-1, they can get rid of those T cells by taking advantage of their natural pathway. But what some of these new reagents do, particularly the bi and trispecific antibodies, is they now allow us, you know, to fight fire with fire. If the T cells and the tumors have multiple contact points, and we now want to create new ones that bring things together in more effective ways, we can now target multiple molecules simultaneously. And without getting into a lot of depth, what I can tell you is that we've now been able to generate trispecific antibodies that do this, and they do it, and some of them do it in different ways. And in this particular approach, what we've done is we've put two specificities on this antibody that target the T cell. So the T cell that will kill the tumor target that you're interested in. And the reason for putting two is that, as for those of you who remember back to your basic immunology 101, a T cell needs really two signals to respond to a foreign antigen. Signal one, which is through the T cell receptor, that's CD3. And then it needs this co-receptor signal, which in the case of human T cells actually is delivered through CD28 on the surface of the T cell. That's signal two, which after you get that initial burst kind of modulates it and allows that cell to survive longer. If you just activate CD3, you'll get a brief activation and then those cells die prematurely. It's called activation-induced cell death. So it gives us a way in one molecule of delivering signal one, signal two, which is more potent for the T cell. And then on the other side, we can target it to the cancer. Now in this case, I'm showing you one example that we think might be a good early proof of concept, which is CD19. It's found on B cell lymphomas. It's actually the target that was used to develop proof of concept for CAR T cells. And we think this might be a good place to look at it. But in your mind's eye, you can imagine that this could be replaced by anything. And so, for example, we've made antibodies where we can put HER2 in this position. Our HER2 will target breast cancer. And here's an example of a breast cancer cell where we've looked at the ability of T cells to lyse these cells. So this is actually HER2 itself. And then if you look, these are a couple of controls that aren't relevant today, but if you look at the trispecific antibody, you can see that we're getting very nice killing of breast cancer cells, where we didn't see that with certainly with the monovalent, and actually one of the bivalents is shown here, which is somewhere in between. So again, bringing things together with these multiple specificities that we couldn't do before. You can also imagine that there are other ways to use this. We might be able to target, you know, if we can't get a tumor-specific target, we can actually pick out two targets on the tumor, and we can then target the tumor more selectively compared to normal tissue, and it gives us more specificity in directing that immune response to the target. So a very versatile technology, and one that I think has certainly the potential to contribute to cancer immunotherapy. Well, I want to end the talk with a discussion of dengue virus and really finishing on this theme of how we can use the modern technologies to respond to emerging threats. I'll be brief about dengue. For those of you who spend any time in the tropics, this is a very bad virus, and you will have known about it if you visited these parts of the world. About half of the world's population lives in dengue endemic regions. Until just this past year, there was no way of preventing infection. And the staggering number, and the staggering statistics are that when I say half the world's population, it literally is 3.9 billion people living in these endemic regions. Of that, about 10% become infected. So every year, About 390 million people get infected. Of those, about a quarter of them are symptomatic. Of those, about 500,000 have this severe form of dengue, which is this acute hemorrhagic fever. And about 2.5%, which translates into about probably 20 to 25,000 deaths per year from dengue. You never hear about it, it doesn't make the headlines, but it has enormous public health impacts around the world. Dengue is a flavivirus, and you know, one of the things that we've seen over the years at Sanofi Pasteur, our vaccine group, is that they've had extraordinary success in making vaccines against flaviviruses. The prototypic one, of course, is yellow fever vaccine. If you travel to South America and Africa, it's a vaccine you want to get because the disease is often fatal. Japanese encephalitis virus, and most recently dengue. And they all have the same genetic structure. What's remarkable is that on the surface of these viruses, they're very closely related on the inside. The only external thing that the immune system sees is the envelope and this leader sequence. And I'll come back to that in a minute. There, with dengue, it's a mosquito-borne infection. There are four different types of dengue. There are four different serotypes of dengue. And as with poliovirus, when we were first trying to develop a poliovirus, unless you hit all four strains, you're not going to have a highly effective vaccine. And so that was essentially the strategy behind the dengue virus. What was done is that we went back to the original prototype yellow fever vaccine. As I said, yellow fever is a... is the microphone on? Can you hear me back there? Okay. So yellow fever, I mentioned, is a flavivirus. We were able to go back to a subclone of the yellow fever virus that was very safe and not with no side effects. And we could then slot in to the yellow fever vaccine the four different dengue virus envelopes. They were done in four different strains, and then they were all mixed together. And that's the vaccine that then went forward into trials. It was called Chimeravax because it was like a chimeric flavivirus vaccine. Looks like we're being reborn here. Okay, thank you, Gordon. This slide just says that despite decades of research, there were no treatments. This actually shows the molecular cloning strategy. So if you look here on the right, you can see here are the four subunits of the vaccine. And in each case, they have the backbone of yellow fever just with that pre-M and E region of the different dengue virus pseudotypes inserted. And these are attenuated, they replicate, but they don't cause any disease. And so basically there were two large phase three studies that were done, one in Asia and one in the Americas, both the Caribbean, Mexico, and Northern South America, and then mostly in the Philippines and Thailand. And here are the take-home results, and this is really the only thing you need to know about this vaccine. So the overall reduction in dengue infection was about 66% against all four serotypes. The most remarkable thing, and the reason this now has been gone out and is being deployed as a licensed vaccine, is that, you know, when you get infected with dengue the first time, you're sick, but you're not that sick. The second time you get infected, that's when you, and particularly in certain strain combinations, that's when you'll get really sick, and that's where all the deaths will come from. And what this vaccine does is that it reduces hospitalization by over 80%, and it reduces severe dengue by more than 90%. And that's important not only for the poor people who are getting infected by this virus, but also, you know, just what it does for public health. Because in the places where dengue exists, the healthcare infrastructure is not particularly robust. You may have, you know, one or two hospitals in these remote regions that are serving a lot of people. And if you get a dengue outbreak and your emergency room fills up, which it does with hospitalized dengue, because you saw the numbers of people getting infected. If somebody has a bicycle accident or a car accident and they get brought into the hospital, they just don't get treated because there's no medical personnel available. So this is an example where, even though the vaccine is targeted for the people who get infected and it's meant to protect them, its effects on public health are greater than the sum of its individual parts. And so, as I said, it's now being deployed in Brazil. I think it just started in the Philippines. There are about four or five countries. Mexico, I think, is getting ready to deploy. But it's really on its way out. And the most important point, and another thing just to remember, and this is now wearing my industry hat, is that this effort on dengue started at Sanofi Pasteur well before I got there. It started 20 years ago. These guys stayed with it for 20 years. We estimate that the amount of resources and investment that was put into this disease probably was north of $1.5 billion. And so you can see that, you know, that it isn't trivial getting these things out, and it takes a lot of resolve and a lot of long-term commitment, and it also does take that know-how, that industrial know-how to make the vaccine and to scale it at this kind of level where you have to get hundreds of millions of doses out. And that gets to the last point of my talk, which is that we've all now lived and seen the devastating effects of this new flavivirus, Zika. For those who don't know, Zika is as closely related in terms of genetically to dengue as any dengue virus is to another strain of dengue. There are about 60%. Zika is 60% related to dengue. Dengue 1 is about 60% to dengue 2. So it's a family member. It's definitely a family member. And so when this outbreak occurred and when we all began to realize the kinds of devastating effects that this virus has, particularly on the unborn, and not only on the unborn, but also in terms of Guillain-Barré in a broader population, we decided that we would work with our partners both at the NIH and Brazil and the US Army and BARDA in the US government to try to respond to this outbreak. This goes through the time course, and again, I think it's a lesson in how we respond and adjust to viral infections and monitor them. Zika is not a new virus. It was discovered in 1947. And it was discovered incidentally in animals. It was really picked up by veterinarians in a colony in Central Africa, and it was just considered a bystander infection, which it was, because if you look at the time course, there were isolated cases in 54, a few more isolated cases in the 60s. It was around 2007. That we started to see some of the first cases actually in Yap, which is a small island in Micronesia. That was the first one. And then it just started to sweep through. You can see 2012 to 14 in Southeast Asia, and then basically spreading across to the French Polynesian islands, and then eventually to Brazil and the Americas, and it's starting up in the Caribbean now as well. Puerto Rico, Haiti, it's just started to break out in those places as well. What this slide is supposed to do, besides make you sick, is to show you just how close this is flipping back and forth between dengue and Zika. The bottom line is, if you can look quickly enough when it's in focus, it doesn't usually project like this, there are just minuscule differences in terms of the packing of the envelope of these viruses. Take my word for it, and I apologize if So as you might imagine, what we can do, among other things, is to take the same backbone that we use for dengue, but instead of putting dengue inserts here, we can now put Zika, and we can generate a Chimeravax for Zika. And that's one of the approaches. This one's going to take a little bit longer. There are going to be three vaccines that you're going to see. You're going to see genetic vaccines, DNA vaccines, RNA vaccines. They're going to come the quickest because we can make them technologically quicker. But we can't scale them up so quickly. And they're probably not as potent as we would like to have for a broad population. But you'll see those first. And I think you could see them as soon as June, you know, but into the early fall, I think that's the time frame. There will be an inactivated wild-type vaccine. I think it's possible that will get into trials. Again, we're talking phase one, not licensure, probably by the end of next year. And then this one will come last because we have to make all the recombinants and do all the safety testing. This one has the greatest potential to be manufactured and scaled and go out to large numbers of people. The other one, particularly the inactivated one, has the greatest chance of showing us whether a vaccine can work. And so these tracks have to go forward in parallel, and then we have to see if we can get it out there in time. I did want to make one comment that, and it gets back to this issue of the pharmaceutical industry and manufacturing. Key here for any of the vaccines I've talked about today is our ability to manufacture it at the scale we need, and at a price that's affordable. There's innovation and great science, actually, that's going on in this area, too. We have these new bioreactors where we can continuously perfuse cells. We can actually grow them in a 50-liter bioreactor, and we can feed them with fresh media every day, and we can siphon off cells and media that are in that bioreactor and essentially keep them growing at steady state for months at a time. And what that allows us to do is to now, instead of building pilot plants, and you know, for example, this is what we do with flu, we have four production plants that are each of which are huge buildings, and in total can get us, you know, maybe 200 million doses. We've done the calculation with this continuous flow. One 50-liter bioreactor can get us 100 million doses of a new vaccine, where otherwise we had to have these four buildings. So it's an important part of what pharma can do and what, you know, can actually help bring the scientific discovery and the innovation really to the many people around the world who need it. And that is one of the things that is very special about pharma in this whole industry and why particularly the vaccine groups have to stay involved and in the game. I want to finish with this last slide. For those of you who are interested, you can read this editorial that I wrote with Elias Erhouni, who is my boss and former NIH director at Sanofi. He's my boss at Sanofi and former NIH director. I should make sure I get that right. And in this, we talk about the steps we need to take for Zika. But the real point of this article, and I think the take-home point for probably all of us in this room, is that we have seen this movie before of emerging viruses. We've seen it with avian flu. We've seen it with SARS. We've seen it with MERS. We've seen it with, now we see it with Zika. And there are others that you've seen it with Ebola, which is probably the one that clearly paralyzed a good portion of the world. And we really, in many ways, haven't learned from these experiences. We still, when we see an outbreak, we respond reactively instead of proactively. We don't have a system in place that does global surveillance that can translate that knowledge into interventions that could put us ahead of the curve. I think the bottom line is it takes time to develop a vaccine. One of the Ebola vaccines that was tested in Africa was one that we developed in my lab at NIH. We started working on that vaccine in 1995. And it was only because we'd been working on it for almost 20 years that it was ready to go. But that was luck. It was luck that we were, you know, we had called it and put enough research. We need a better system for engaging the public sector, the governments, the academic sector, the foundations, industry, to all come together and be smart about the way we respond. Because if we don't, I can assure you with Zika today, it will be something else tomorrow. And I think we should be smarter than that and really learn from the mistakes of our past and do better in the future. So to summarize, it's pretty simple. Our scientific knowledge, in this case, structure-based design, recombinant viral technology, offers us new approaches to prevention of treatment of infectious diseases and cancer. And they can allow us to specifically modulate our focus and our use of the immune system to improve both the therapies and preventive approaches to these diseases. And I would like to acknowledge, I can't acknowledge everybody who's been involved in all aspects of the work, but I'd like to tell you about at least some of the highlights in HIV at the VRC at NIH. John Mascola, Peter Kwong, Mario Roederer, and their labs, and then Zuling Wu, Ziyang Yang, and Tongqing Zhao were the guys in the labs who were actually doing the work. Mark Connors on some of the broadly neutralizing antibody work. My colleague, and who's passed away since this work was done, great non-human primate virologist and immunologist Norm Letvin, who was very much involved in these studies. Colleagues at Scripps, Ian Wilson, Dennis Burton, and now Bill Sheaf, who's actually since gone to Scripps. I would like to say at Sanofi, we do have a fantastic team. Some of my lab has joined me from the NIH at Sanofi, but we also have a really wonderful bioengineering group based in Frankfurt, Germany, who's been involved in these technologies, and we continue to collaborate with the VRC. The group who worked on the dengue vaccine is so numerous you wouldn't be able to put them on one slide. This is what happens when you get 20 years of work and put $1.5 billion. It's an amazing effort, but you should just realize the number of individuals in that organization who contributed to the effort, and it's a great example of what happens when people work in teams and really stay at a problem and follow it to its logical conclusion. So I'll stop there and be happy to take questions. Thanks. About it a lot. I was telling some of my hosts here today. I my son's fiance is very likely to be a competitor in those Olympics, and so we think about it often, and including whether or not we should go and watch her in her event. You know, what I would say is that for those who are going to be in Rio, particularly the athletes, probably the greater threat to their health will not be from Zika, it will be from dengue, and it will be from the microbes, the bacteria, that the waste system, the sewage system in Rio is not very good. And you may recall there were some regattas in Brazil last year, where almost all of the rowers got sick from the water. So there are numerous medical issues, and I understand the U.S. Olympic Committee is going to actually have several physicians that are going to be there with the teams. In terms of Zika, you know, I think that it's probably a manageable risk there. I think that the incidence of Zika in Rio itself it is not as high. It's actually higher when you go more north into Brazil, because it's a little bit more temperate there, and it will be at a time when it's winter there. And so I think that will. So I think if the proper precautions are taken, if particularly the precautions around childbirth and testing before and after, I think it's a manageable risk. But obviously, it's a concern, and I think that there's no black and white answer. I think that everybody, every athlete, every fan is going to have to make those decisions for themselves. What I do think, though, is that the CDC guidelines should be followed very carefully, because the part that I didn't talk about is this wild card in Zika, which is the phenomenon of sexual transmission. It's real, and it does contribute to some of the neonatal exposures, and that's a worry. So I think that anybody who travels there that's planning to have a child, male or female, needs to be tested after they return. And if they are positive, I think they need to wait a significant period of time. We don't know exactly what that period of time is, but the CDC is making some recommendations. And if the partner of a traveler is pregnant and the male needs to use contraception, absolutely, it's not something to take a risk with. And so I think it has to be managed with more of what we would call the traditional public health things. And those are individual judgments that people will need to make for themselves. What I would say from a public health point of view is that I don't know that the travel in and out of Brazil is going to disseminate this virus any more than it's already going to be disseminated. There are planes going in and out of there already every day, And as we know, it's really gotten up to the Caribbean. There have not been any cases in the U.S. that have been mosquito-borne. But there are some areas in the U.S. where the Aedes aegypti mosquito is found. I hate to, try to predict Mother Nature, but we have had one, maybe analogous threat recently to the U.S. that didn't materialize, and that was chikungunya virus. Chikungunya is also transmitted by the Aedes aegypti mosquito. It devastated the Caribbean. I mean, if you went to Jamaica and just talked to people who, and the disease is a pretty horrible disease, too. It causes acute arthritis, and then in some people, chronic arthritis. It never took off in the U.S., and many of us were really worried that it would. And the reason is that the Aedes aegypti is only found in these very small pockets in Florida and Texas. And beyond that, it's not very common. We also use a lot more air conditioning in the U.S. than we do in a lot of the developing countries. So maybe we have some reason to be hopeful that it might not spread into the U.S. The reason I'm a little cautious is that, viruses evolve and they can change host range, so I don't want you to take that as an absolute. We can just guess at this point.
One more question of Stephanie.
Could you comment on the advantages of tri-specific antibodies versus our technology? And yes, there are considerations that people try to merge those two strategies. In other words,
it's an interesting one.
Yeah, so just to repeat your question, is you wanted to sort of compare and contrast tri-specific antibodies with CAR T cells, and also might there be ways to put the two together? You know, I think, first of all, it's conceivable you could make a tri-specific on a CAR. We haven't explored that, but it's possible. And it could help with targeting. I think, as you know, one of the big problems with CAR T cells has been the ability to really specifically recognize the tumor cell and not other cell types. There have been deaths in CAR T cell trials when targets have been pursued that are on normal tissue. There, I don't know if you're familiar, but there was one CAR T cell that was directed against a protein called Titan, which was found on mesothelial, I think it's mesothelial cells, but it was also found in the heart. And patients who got that died from arrhythmia. So having a tool that can allow you to be more specific would, you know, that's a potential way forward. What we're hoping, and again, it's still early days, is that, you know, what we're trying to do, at least with the approach I showed you here today, is we're trying essentially to create CAR T cells in vivo in the body without ever having to take them out and grow them, you know, ex vivo. We're essentially delivering the kinds of signals that would promote their outgrowth, direct them to the tumor cell, but without, and as you know, the CAR T cells are very exciting in the places that where they've worked, but they're an amazing technical tour de force. You have to, you know, and imagine if you wanted to apply CAR T cells at a large scale in the population, you gotta get the blood from your patients, you gotta send it someplace where they can, in a GMP sterile fashion, transduce the cells, you gotta do quality control to show that the cells have gotten the gene in enough percentage that it will work, ship it back to the hospital has to infuse it, your side effects from the therapy, they often go on to, you know, they often go into an ICU. It's not the way we wanna, you know, treat our patients. So I take the CAR T cells as being a proof of concept that if you activate T cells the right way and find the right antigen, that they can eradicate at least certain types of tumor. And so if we can do that and learn from their lesson, you know, without all of those high-tech and challenging ex vivo approaches, that would be great. If not, and if it doesn't work and we have to go to using that approach, we will. But I'd love to not have to do that if we can avoid it. But the idea of combining them is an interesting one.
I think we'll call it there. And please join us for the reception across the way. And join me in thanking Dr. Nabel for